Welcome back from that very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasajja. Today, we are asking Nancy Kalembe whether Uganda is ripe for a female president. Nancy, when we went for the break, you were asserting that Uganda's poverty is artificial. But you know the government has created programs to eradicate poverty. We have had several programs from poverty alleviation programs from 1996. There, of course, there might be policy issues that are stampeding, that are stopping Uganda from progressing, okay? But for you to say that Uganda's leaders have deliberately decided that Ugandans should be poor is a huge statement that you need to probably underscore and give us evidence as to why you think Uganda's leaders want the people they lead to be poor.
I have worked with communities and families. And in a home where there is a stepmother, food is cooked and it is provided. But if the husband is not attentive to his children who were there before that stepmother was in the home, it does not mean that all the children are being well nourished. Do you understand the ideology? The point I'm trying to make.
Sure.
Just because food is cooked in a home, mukatata, as we usually call them, your stepmother will smile and lay the table or lay the mat with the plates and the food. But the father sits on the table somewhere and he's paying attention to his food while the mama is feeding the children. If you ask the father whether he provides food for his children, he will say, yes, he does. But do all the children eat food? If you ask the father whether he pays school fees, yes, he does. But do all the children go to school on time, or are others kept behind in the garden stealing while the stepmother's children are late to go to school early, while the rest go and fetch water, fetch firewood, and they don't partake of the things that their father is providing? This is the situation Uganda is in. Let me say it again on camera, because I said it during the break. Uganda's poverty is artificially created by those in power who think that it is easier to rule over poor people. Because a hungry man is not going to ask for policies. A hungry man or woman is going to ask for the basic needs like food and water. We are in a very interesting time in history where the world has become a global village, and we are talking about sustainable development goals. And we are sitting down and discussing and saying we should bring poverty to zero. And yet in a country that is as blessed as Uganda, why I say the poverty in this country is artificially created is because there are very few countries in the world.
Nancy,
that, let me
this.
Finish this point. Uganda is one of the few countries in the world that has two rainy seasons. Uganda is one of the few countries in the world that has very fertile soil. If I eat a mango and throw it outside, if it is not swept away, a tree will grow. We have fertile land. We have able-bodied people. Ugandans are very hardworking and they are very, very enterprising. In a country that is giving tax holidays to investors, foreign investors, a country that is giving free land to foreign investors, making free money or cheaper financing available to foreign investors. Can you imagine if those incentives were turned to Ugandans?
The same country, just a few days ago on the International Youth Day, said it had given billions of money to to young people in the Youth Livelihood Program, in the Youth Capital Venture, and thousands and thousands of young people have benefited from these programs. While on the other hand, I don't know how much you are saying that they should be doing. I don't think a government that is injecting all that money, we have skilling programs, in these young people is out intentionally to make them impoverished.
I studied a course unit at the university called Monitoring and Evaluation. Uganda has some of the best written policies. Listen, we have very good written policy, well-written policies. We have professors who have come up with wonderful ideas. Actually, some of our professors have written some of the documents that have helped our neighboring countries develop. Now, saying and doing are two different things. That is why I started with that course unit I did at the university called Monitoring and Evaluation. It speaks for itself. For me to release, it is the same thing that I gave as an example in the family. When the father provides money but does not sit with the children to ensure that they are eating the food, it means he's not carrying out monitoring his family. You need to evaluate when money is released. Does it get to where it's going, or does it get to certain fat cats that get fatter and fatter? When you talk about money being released for hospitals, have you actually gone to the hospitals? Let's not talk about what we read about in the newspapers, because Ugandans, we the people who have gone to school, who think we understand a little bit more than everybody else, we sit down and read newspapers. We sit down and read statistics. Let us be realistic. Statistics are in a book. Real life is happening on the ground. Go to the villages. I am telling you, I went around distributing food in Uganda, not in another country. If someone is saying that money was collected for help during COVID time, why are hospitals turning around people who have COVID-19 right now? Why? Because the money didn't get there. Children are dying in hospitals. A mother is blessed to give birth to 6 children, and you're telling me that money was released? I don't want to hear about the money that is released.
Nancy, you, well, giving the
I
example,
want to hear example, the money example. That has arrived and the projects that are being done. Recently, I visited farmers in Masaka. They are coffee farmers. They have come together. They decided that they are not going to wait for government yet, Uyambe. They have decided to come together as coffee farmers. And they have done a great job. They have managed to access external markets. They sell their coffee. They work together as a community. I think Uganda has relied so much on a government that is not actually monitoring the money they claim they are sending out. So as far as someone on the ground is concerned, you cannot tell me that money was released.
Nancy,
when my children are failing to go to school.
Using your example, you said you talked of the sugarcane growing in Busoga.
Yes.
And everyone agrees probably it was a policy in the wrong direction, because people will not have enough food to grow for their sustainability.
I didn't say it was a policy in the wrong direction. I said it was mismanaged.
You have not challenged the leaders that have championed sugarcane growing in Busoga, and you're here saying you're going to challenge the presidency that has not been able probably to follow up money in Mukono for the Youth Livelihood Program.
Listen, not everybody who wants to serve wants to get into battle. There have been leaders in the past who have battled, insulted, fought. It has not come to anything. That is why I'm offering Ugandans a different option. Let's come in peace. If you do not lose yourself, most of the leaders who are coming out and presenting themselves as presidential candidates are either disgruntled, angry people who have left either the NRM or whatever other party they have come out of because their needs were not met, or they did not ascend to a place they needed to ascend, or their ideas were not listened to. That is not the kind of leader that Uganda needs right now. Uganda needs a level-headed leader who's going to talk about practical things that can be done to move someone from where they are now to where they need to go. Now, when we talk about leaving no one behind, this is what we mean. Number one, when people talk about poverty, 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 what can we do? As I speak about poverty being artificial, that is a problem. We need to talk about a solution. And I'm asking you, I know we have very little time, to give me a few minutes to discuss what I would like to do about this poverty. First of all, we have communities. We say that Uganda's the backbone of Uganda's economy is agriculture. What have we done about it? What percentage has gone into the agriculture sector? What incentives are being put in the agriculture sector? When taxes are being imposed on the agriculture sector, who are they affecting? Who really gets affected? Is it the middleman who gets to sell up here, or is it actually affecting the farmer down there? Now, these are the ideas we, as Mission 56, are coming with. By the way, Mission 56 stands for... Mission 56 is a group of young individuals who are bringing productive change to Uganda. 56 tribes of Uganda, leaving no one behind. We're not leaving anybody, whether you're from Buganda, Busoga, Bunyoro, wherever you're coming from, the 56 original tribes of Uganda, we are moving together. Now,
Nancy, before we go back to the policy issue, I just don't want to lose a point with you mentioning Mission 56.
Yes.
Why would you choose to run under the umbrella Mission 56 under the slogan "Leaving No One Behind"? Your father, Patrick Bagaya, was a very eminent and vocal NRM leader in Busoga region. Are you giving? Is it an indictment on political parties in Uganda on your behalf? Why do you choose to stand as an independent, yet your family is a well-known NRM?
Thank you so much for that question. It is a beautiful question. It gives me an opportunity to explain more about Mission 56. Now, Uganda is a third world country. Everybody knows that. Uganda, we all know that there is power in numbers. We are 45 million people who all want the same thing. We want a better life, better education, better health. We want to grow and develop as a country. However, we know that divided we fall, united we stand. Uganda is divided by tribe. Uganda is divided by religion. Now, we are further divided by this artificial animal called political parties. Why should we continue to be fragmented as Ugandans instead of working together? Mission 56, by the way, is not a political party. It is a movement for all Ugandans to remember that we are Ugandans. Divided, we fall. United, we stand. As Mission 56, our slogan is leaving no one behind, regardless of your tribe, regardless of your religion, and regardless of political party. I do not want to work with any political party or any tribe or any religion. I want to work with Ugandans because we are Ugandans first. That is why we can move religion. That is why we can marry across tribe. That is why we can move from one political party to another. But we are Ugandans. And even if my father was one of the NRM cadres, the people who started NRM, the ideologies that he shared while I was growing up, unfortunately, I do not see them much now. Number one, NRM, do you remember what it stands for? Or do you only remember the letters?
It was a movement. Organization.
It was a movement. No, it was not a political party.
Yes, it was a political system. That's what I'm talking about.
But it was a movement for all Ugandans, redeeming Ugandans from bad politics, redeeming Ugandans from bad leadership. A lot of people joined the movement because it was a movement for all Ugandans. Later on, it morphed into a political party, meaning it took part in the fragmentation of an already fragmented nation. So I do not, unfortunately, my father died. May his soul rest in peace. My father was a people person. People loved him in Busoga. They called him Bageya.
Ensolo etayigika.
Ensolo enkambwe. He was like the protector. He protected, he worked for, he served. He didn't believe in this selfish transactional leadership that has become of our nation. He believed in building schools, building roads, serving, helping people go to school. Not in the selfish, buy myself a big car, build myself a very large house. And I remember while we were growing up, we would have 200 guests sleeping over in one night. And if we needed to find a tent in the middle of the night, we found it. And that is how we lived.
Nancy,
we lived
in
together.
A nutshell, you're saying you're going to be a politician that does not believe in building a multi-party democracy in a country. I don't know how that is going to work out because I haven't seen any countries that progress on the line, on the democratic trajectory without building political parties as institutions. Or at
you
least...
See,
political
everything, organizations. Everything is created under the sun. Kingdoms were just formed. Democracy was just formed in Greece and it spread to the rest of the world. We need, and Africa
but
always,
it's what you espouse.
Africa always follows what the Western world provides for us. Without us thinking truly what works for us. Just like we completely embraced their medicine. And I'm not saying their medicine is bad, but we forgot about our natural medicine. We know that if you got malaria, you drank mululuza, you got fine. But now that has been forgotten. We cannot completely forget who we are and embrace somebody else. Multi-party politics is where Uganda is. And for those who love it, it is wonderful. I believe it fragments us even further, divides us even further. If people want to continue with their multi-party politics, it is a good thing. I, as the next president of Uganda, will abstain from joining any political party. I will let them run and enjoy, let them enjoy what they call democracy. But as the head of the country, I should think I should be non-partisan so that when I am giving services and goods to the people of Uganda, I am giving services regardless of which political party you are. We need Uganda, for Uganda to develop, we need Uganda to be a meritocracy where people are given jobs because of what you know, of what you can do, your abilities and talents, not because you're the minister of this, because you supported me in my campaign, and because you belong to my political party. That means we are going to put people who are not qualified in certain offices because we are paying attention to tribe, religion, parties. That is nonsense. For Uganda to develop, we need workers who are ready to work. Workers who are selfless, who will serve regardless. That is why our country as it is, it has failed in many places because we are thinking, how many people, how many ministers are in place because they belong to the NRM?
Nancy,
and yet there are so many other people who are well equipped, who are well versed, who have a lot of knowledge and can bring so much to the table, who have been left behind. Why? Because they belong to UPC or DP?
Nancy, I want to drag you back to the policy issues. But before we go, I know you're a devout, born-again Christian. You said you want a country that does not look at the culture, the religious, and our tribal settings. And are you saying these things that are dear to Ugandans, for example, culture and religion, should not be anywhere, should not play a role in the body politic of Uganda. And if you're saying, yes, they shouldn't play a role in the body politic of Uganda, what does that say of the disintegrating social fabric of Uganda? You've had churches raised, and so, I mean, if key institutions, if key values are not part of the body politic of Uganda, how are you going to be able to synchronize this?
I am a born-again Christian. I gave my life to Christ in 1988. I have served in different churches all my life until I started serving at National Fellowship for Born-Again Pentecostal Churches, and most recently with Interreligious Council. Now, being a born-again Christian means I am a child of God. And when you read the Bible, when God created man, he didn't bring religion. He brought human beings that he loved, that he wanted to commune with. Whatever faith someone belongs to, they have believed that this is the vehicle that they are going to use to reach their maker. That is a personal decision, my friend. That should not bring division. Because I'm a born-again Christian, do you know why I work with Interreligious Council? Because we are all children of God. You have spoken about my family and how we are NRM. A lot of my family members are NRM. Not all of us are. Did you know that I come from a family that is half Christian and half Muslim? And on Idi, Alhaji Chirunda Chivei Dinda is my uncle. And we grew up in the same house. And on Idi, we celebrate Idi. And on Christmas Day, we celebrate Christmas. You know what growing up in such a family has taught me? Understanding and tolerance. We are children of God. My personal faith is what happens between me and God in my private space. What happens between you and your God is your business. But when we are working together, I expect basic human character of love, peace, and kindness. I wonder when we are going to get back to the policy issue, because I really want to talk about how we plan to deal with poverty.
But Nancy, one of the issues that bedevils Ugandans, especially in the business, the private sector, has been Uganda's tax regime. What do you think? How do you think it can be reformed? Do you think it is a fair tax regime, or do you think there needs to be a change in shift in how we handle our tax issues?
Of course, change has to happen in every sector. URA in the past few years has talked about increasing the tax base. By increasing the tax base, I guess they've been meaning increasing the people who are already heavily taxed. And let's add some more tax to the people who are already heavily burdened by tax. Let's go back to the Bible. Tithe is 10%. God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, requires only 10% of us, of our earnings. Our government is approaching 40% in a country where we do not even see where the money is going.
Are you sure? Because we have healthy centers at
We have moved from where we were in 1980, and so are many other countries. How you looked like in 1980, if you were around, is not how you look like now. But just because in 1986 my mother was chasing me around, go and bathe, and I didn't like to bathe or smear, does not mean that 34 years later I should be chased around, go and bathe, go and smear. It means that by now I may not be Bill Gates, but I am at least bathing and smearing. Now, for people to say that Uganda has moved, it is good. How much money were we collecting then, and how much are we collecting now? About the tax base, thank you very much. Now, we have been made to believe that having a big population that is young is actually a disadvantage. That is where I talk about the artificial poverty. Well, the demographics, if you look at, I studied Bachelor of Science in Population Studies. So certain demographic pyramids are more disadvantaged to others. That is a whole different topic. We shall discuss that later. But what I am trying to get at is this. If Ugandans were ably involved in economic activities and they were gainfully employed, we would not have to have a very heavy tax on the few who are employed. Why? That is what I want to get to now. So give me a few minutes. When we talk about social businesses, as some of the things that we want to bring in place, we talk about the agriculture sector being the backbone of our economy. And this is what I'm saying. Every community has an agricultural activity that they have been good at, that they have perfected over the years since generations passed. Now, as we get to this time, we know about value addition. We have global markets. So what happens? Can our government actually help? This is what my government will be doing. When we come into office, come 2021, we shall make sure that we help and facilitate social businesses so that Jaja Namkaka and Jaja Besweri will be able to benefit from their small land as they are growing. How? We shall help the individuals who have gone to school from those areas to set up companies. That will be the social, the community businesses. Now, in those community businesses, how many people will you employ? The lawyer who is carrying out the registration, the accountant, the food scientist who is going to add value, the factory workers, Jaja who is going to be collecting maybe manure and packaging the manure and selling it and all that. That is the social business. I'm summarizing because of time. Now, after the social business, we have what we call like Uganda Industrial Research Institute, business incubation centers, where people can come in. The business incubation centers that the government has right now are few. We need regional and community business centers to incubate these young businesses so that anybody who can come in and have a business idea can be helped to develop business skills, accounting, financial literacy, marketing, have export promotions board help them, Uganda standards body coming in to help them meet the standards, and so that they can develop their product and not sell it only in Uganda but abroad. Now, that's so the second thing. Now, the third thing, just hold on. The third thing that we want to do besides that, we want to have the talent development centers that are community-based. We've had our musicians, our sports people, people in acting, film, and drama. We want to put them in talent development centers, which will be community talent development centers, so that these ones not only provide jobs, but help people develop whoever they are. That way, we shall be dealing with the poverty that I say is artificially created.
Nancy, women die in labor, children die, some die, about like 18% of women die in... But basically, what is your take on access to universal health care?
Actually, the number is much higher than that. According to the most recent statistics from USAID. Anyway, let's not dwell on the statistics because it is very sad. Now, life begins in the womb for everybody. For a government that does not pay attention to mothers during pregnancy and after is a government that is not aware where life begins. Ugandans, as you said in the beginning, are not ready for a female president. The male presidents we've had do not understand the challenges of carrying a child and hoping that the child does not die. The governments that have come before mine do not understand the pain of delivering a child and the child dies. The government does not understand the pain of watching a sick child when you do not have money to take them to hospital. I am a mother. I have been to the hospitals and seen my fellow mothers give birth on the floor because I've worked as a volunteer in Mulago. and on Ward 5, where the mothers used to give birth, we'd go with a group of friends and help out these mothers and just volunteer night after night, because during the day, there are so many volunteers. But in the night, we used to go between midnight and 4 a.m. in the night to serve the women who were giving birth on the general ward. And the sight was sickening. Why? The nurses are exhausted. The doctors are tired and they are so few. And our leaders go to these hospitals during the day. Have you heard of any male leader who actually goes to the labor ward in the middle of the night uninvited so that he can see the actual truth? The reason why our leaders are blinded and they think that Uganda is developing is because they announce that tomorrow I am going to Mulago Hospital. See what Magufuli did when he became president. He started going to places unannounced, and that way he saw the real issues of the people they were leading. That is an example of a good leader who actually is involved in the real issues of the people. Now, when we talk about the story in Mulago is changing, is it accessible by everybody right now?
No, because you have to.
Mulago is a referral hospital. As a government,
but that's for the neonatal section.
I pay taxes. After I have paid taxes, and I am called that my cousin in Iganga has had a stillbirth because the doctors were not available to help them, yet I'm paying taxes, I wonder where my taxes are going. I do not want to see, you see, Uganda is not Kampala Road. Uganda is not Kampala. You need to go to Luwero, to Masaka, to Iganga, to Kamuli, to Kotido. You need to go to those places and meet Uganda. If you are on Kampala Road or in Kampala, you have not met Uganda. When you meet families that are eating mangoes for lunch, then you have met Uganda. When you meet families that have land, but the little that they produce, some middlemen come and take advantage of them and threaten them. When you meet Ugandans who are losing their land.
Last 1 minute for you to give us your parting shot. What is your parting shot to Ugandans?
I am calling upon Ugandans to stand with me and walk with me on this journey. I know that we have been used to highly monetized elections. Please forget about the leaders who are giving you money. They are bribing you. And therefore, you cannot ask them for accountability. You cannot call them to integrity, because they took you off your moral high horse the day they paid you to give them a vote. I am asking you, Ugandans, stand with me, walk with me, and let me be your next president. And together, we shall make poverty history, because we shall deal with real issues on a daily basis. We shall walk together and turn this country into a country that we are proud of.
Whether it's Nancy Kalembe or President Yoweri Museveni, the power lies in your hands. For us here at Urban TV, be sure to catch the checkpoint tomorrow. Good night.